We are going live.
We are live. I love it.
Welcome, guys, and welcome to episode 13 of the weekly. And with me, of course, this week is the one and only Mr. Juan Bagnell.
What is up? West Coast represent. I got my coffee. Let's do this.
All right. This is a busy week, but not for tech entertainment.
Yeah, I think we can plow through the tech show pretty easily.
Yeah, pretty much. But you know, let's start off with I think the uselessness of the week, and okay. We'll just kick the show off. So, right after we finished our show last week, a whole bunch of steals and information on the LG G4 leaked out on the web. And this was not from some leaking website. This is actually from LG's microsite.
This was so funny about how this all broke down.
Yeah, it showed us specs. Even though some of the specs listed on the site were off, talking about, you know, still 30 megapixels, Android 4.4. So I'm thinking it's 16, Android 5.0.
Well, I think when we start looking at, so basically what happened is LG built a site for the G4. And they didn't do a very good job of hiding the fact that they built a site for the G4, and people going through parts of LG's online media and online content were able to dig this up. But obviously the people who are building the site aren't going to be privy to all of the exacting information for this product that's coming out. So a lot of the stuff that was on there, I think, was placeholder information too.
Yeah. You know,
instead of putting lorem ipsum all over your website, you can just throw the specs from the G3 on there and
change the numbers, yeah.
All you have to do is punch in new numbers when you're ready to go live. As soon as you get all that information, you get that communique. But we still got enough, and especially with all the photos that were built into the site, too.
Yeah, so we got a whole lot. We got the fact that LG has a new leather fetish, and it's all about that brown leather, you know. So that was heavily implicated in there. Also, talked about the camera a lot, you know, the fact that it's f1.8. Also, the fact it can do a couple of different modes, you know, it's got a super fast shutter, it's got a color sensor, all this stuff in there. And it looks like LG is trying to shape it. I mean, not trying to. It is a competitor to the S6 as well as the M9. But it looks like, I mean, even though I call it uselessness because of the leak, I was kind of happy to see what LG was trying to put out in terms of a product, you know, there. So,
But last year, LG actually had a very interesting take on their cameras, right? While everyone was still going on OIS and trying to do different focus technology, LG was going directly to laser technology.
They still have OIS in there, though.
Yeah, but it's going to be interesting to see if they still use that laser focus. Because if you remember on the LG G3, when you turn on the camera, it's pretty snappy. It popped up pretty fast.
Well, so according to the leak, it's got laser focus still, but it's got OIS 2.0.
Oh yeah.
Well, so here's the experience that I've been through, and I don't think I've got it within arm's reach.
Reach.
Okay, so I'm wrapping up my review on the G Flex 2, and the G Flex 2 is I think a great is a great product to look at in terms of being the evolutionary missing link between the Flex and the G, right? The G4. And the more I play with this and the G3 camera that's sort of built into this G Flex 2, the more I think LG had better be focusing on get it, because laser focus.
oh god.
Had better be focusing on a larger image sensor. That to me is a number one, the one critical thing missing from the LG camera experience is the second you pick up a Galaxy S6, you get creamy backgrounds, beautiful depth of field blur. I mean, I spent a good chunk of my camera review on that GS6 just praising that, because it is a very photographic and it's a very cinematic camera to shoot on, whereas the G3 is sort of the best of the old technology. It's the best that you can do with a smaller image sensor, and it's really only competing against the iPhone at this point, as they're the last two flagship products that use this 1/3 inch sensor, and most other companies are moving up to larger image sensors for prettier photography, prettier video. So, you know, whatever the megapixels might be, whatever the OIS 2.0 or the, you know, laser focus, which I think the iPhone and the Galaxy S6 have caught up to LG's focusing speed and accuracy without having to resort to laser systems. The one thing that I think is holding the LG camera experience back is just literally the physics behind putting in a larger sensor.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. But so that was the sort of uselessness.
I do have a baby uselessness if we can cover it real quick and sure. Just get your initial notes right there. So I just did a review yesterday of 6Discover, which is a Snapchat Discover replacement for Windows Phone. And so, you know, if you've ever used Snapchat, they've got their Discover service. You can tap on little icons. You can get news stories and entertainment fed in really creative little Snapchatty ways. And so Rudy, I don't know how to pronounce his last name. It's H-U-Y-N. And I've been saying Hune, which I think is wrong because I'm not...
Let's just call him Rudy. Let's not mess with his last
name. The superstar developer behind apps like Six Tag, which is an amazing Instagram replacement for Windows Phone users. He had a Snapchat app which got pulled from the store because Snapchat pulled all third-party apps. But he just released this Discover app. So it doesn't use any of your sensitive information, but there are issues with the fact that I'm sure Snapchat has licensing deals with all of the companies that supply content for their Discover service. And so he put out a Discover app, and of course, the day it went live, he got emails and letters from Snapchat lawyers saying, yeah, you're going to have to take this down. But it's just another frustrating aspect of the fact that Windows Phone users have been asking for a Snapchat app. They had third-party apps, which were pulled from the Windows Phone store for security reasons, and now they can't even play with Discover. I mean, I think it's still live in the store now, so if you have a Windows Phone, go grab it. But they can't even play with this one side service from Snapchat because they just refuse to put out anything for Microsoft's OS.
Well, I mean, it's Snapchat. First of all, I still think that company is useless. Anyone who uses Snapchat is cool. The reason why I say it's useless is because of stuff like that, you know. And it's just also a going pattern on Windows Phone in the sense that, look, everybody knows that when Rudy drops an app, you should pay attention. Yep. So if I was Snapchat, I would just either pull all the apps or say, hey, look, Rudy, make one for us, right? Or we'll use your app and we'll buy out from you. You already valued at how many billion dollars? 40 billion now? Oh, not 40, sorry. Mm-hmm. 20 billion, whatever the amount Snapchat is valued. And you can't make a decent app and you call yourself, you're valued at that app. I mean, that's rubbish. Come on. I mean, people want to use your app. It's not like it's a paid service that you think basically, your service is all about getting subscriber information. That's what your service is. So right. if you have even 5 million subscribers, 10 million subscribers off Windows Phone who want to use your service, then why not give them something? You know, why not give them an app to use? So to me, it is pretty much useless. But then again, it's Snapchat. So
what do you think, Sam? Sam, you're muted.
Yeah, I mute myself these days just because.
Well, I mean, that's very kind of you, but, you know, we do occasionally want to hear from you.
Ooh, ouch. Okay, so uselessness of Snapchat, you know, it's one of those things, right? These companies are still, this company is basically still trying to run and find out the best way to control their ecosystem. We saw that Twitter did the same thing with basically kicking all third-party apps for a while, and a lot of people had complaints about Twitter basically shutting down a lot of the Twitter third-party apps that they were used to using on iOS and Android.
Yeah.
So it basically Snapchat's move to kind of own its ecosystem. But in the midst of owning your own ecosystem, you have to basically come to the realization that you're not making enough apps. You're not making apps for a platform. If someone else is making apps for that platform, you want to get the user base. You want every single possible user base you can get. And if the guy's doing something good, if he's not killing the whole Snapchat experience, then I'll say support him. Support him for the meantime, and if possible, buy him out. You know, just buy the user base.
I'm really surprised, though, that Snapchat actually hasn't done the buyout. I know...
Dropbox did.
You know, that's what I think is kind of funny is I don't think you can let the app just stay in the store. So like 6Discover does serve ads. That's how Rudy is going to monetize his app development work. It serves ads, whereas Snapchat Discover service does not serve ads because they've got their own licensing deal arranged and they're looking at other ways of monetizing. Mm-hmm. So I think just in the way that this content is licensed between, you know, like Vice and CNN and the Food Network with Snapchat directly, I don't think as lawyers you could let it stand that someone else was monetizing. It's just a shitty way that content IP deals are usually brokered. But the fact that they won't buy it out tweak it so that it's their preferred experience, and then re-release it on the Windows Phone Store without having to do a ton of support for it. Because we've seen, you know, like Instagram put out an app and they just let it languish. It hasn't been updated in over a year. I'm surprised they're not at least even doing that.
Yeah, or even just ignore it for the time being. You know,
I don't think you can. I think in how you defend IP, it sets up a bad precedent if you let something go too long.
No, but if you put out a statement saying that this is not how Snapchat wants to basically, you know, broker its experience or whatever, you can put out a statement out there that basically puts him on notice but doesn't shut down the usability.
No, I think if you acknowledge it and then don't act to try to remove it, that's even worse.
Because you have partnership deals. But I mean, the thing is that all these companies, right? I'm sorry, you can't. Okay, I don't know how to make apps. I can't make a single app, right? But I know that there are people. I find it very odd. I really do. That there's one guy who can make an app, and then you and your $20 billion valued company cannot do it. Then something is wrong with you. I'm sorry. I'm just saying that the skill set in your company sucks compared to this guy.
Well, and I think Instagram is a perfect example. Like
Instagram is another one too. Yeah, you said
one guy did to make Six Tag, and I think the Six Tag app, for the most part, I mean, I like what Instagram has done with the most recent update of their app, especially on Android.
On Android, I'm interested.
because I haven't touched it on Windows Phone. But what Rudy did by himself in cracking open Instagram's protocols and their sharing features, that was a way better Instagram app than what Instagram could put out for themselves. Mm-hmm. And the fact that they didn't even steal those ideas, you know, just reverse engineer the app. You know, you could have made the entire Instagram service better, but it wasn't their vision of the Instagram service, so they got really sort of stalwart about not doing those things. And you're like, well, that was dumb, because those would have been improvements to the overall experience of using that app.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree, but you know, it's one of those things that it's a problem that Microsoft faces, but it's also a problem. It's also I see it more as a problem of services not recognizing user base. You know, I'm tired of, you know, it kind of even goes up to, you know, I'm going to skip to Meerkat coming to Android. The reason why I'm skipping is because I'm tired of seeing services going only on iOS. Instagram does that constantly. You know, I'm like, look, if you're going to open something on a trial page, if you were sensible, if you know how to do business, iOS first, net first 3 months. I'll tell people that and say, look, we needed to test it out. This is our more secure base. We understand how it is. And then we roll out on Android in 6. Then we roll out everywhere. Just make sure it comes out. Why would you skew your user base? You know, a Hyperlapse video on Instagram. Hyperlapse is only on iOS. You know, half of the world uses Android. I mean, I'm even asking you to throw it on Windows Phone.
Let's even talk about people who are doing it right now. Let's go with Microsoft and Cryogen is doing, right? Cryogen, basically, should I say Microsoft bought a minority stake in Cryogen?
No, they didn't. They didn't. They actually did not.
They didn't buy the minority stake? Because I think
they did not buy the minority stake. But I think they just brokered a deal to actually
now you have Microsoft apps in Android. And it's going to be basically installed in the OnePlus. And in the new, the Oxygen they're calling it? The new OS that they're going to be releasing.
Any device that runs Cyanogenmod will definitely have Microsoft apps.
Yeah, that's a perfectly good way of doing it. It's basically saying, okay, you know what? Let's broker a deal that these guys make really good modded iOS devices. I mean, Android devices or Android OSs. Now, let's just have them push our release. Push out software. Let's have them push the biggest names, Microsoft Office, Microsoft OneNote, and all the other stuff, Skype and Bing, stuff that we want them to push. That's the way to do it. You know, don't hamper people from getting their hands on your software. You want to get it to as many hands as possible.
Yeah, see, because that's the thing. I understand when, you know, Google, Apple, and Microsoft, you know, want to limit it on their ecosystem, because that's what you're supposed to do. But when you are Facebook, because you own Instagram, or Snapchat, or Meerkat, or Periscope, what is the smart idea? Like, literally, you know, like, remember how it took a while for Instagram to build up on Android, and now I think it's probably, I mean, you're probably getting more traffic off Android than iOS devices. I'm just guessing. I don't know. But you're looking at the fact that you have a large user base. The world is your user base. You don't own an ecosystem. Stop being dumb. You don't own an ecosystem.
So I think one of the flaws for Meerkat was they got all of this amazing buzz by being first. Yeah, I mean, think about it. When they came out of South by Southwest, you had all of these.
That was only 2 months ago.
it's broadcasting. It's this. It's that. And their drop off was severe. I don't even think that they were ever like a top 50 app in the iOS App Store. Or if they were, it wasn't for very long. And then they dropped off pretty damn quick. And then my feed got blown up with Periscope. And so, I think they'll score some brownie points if they can be first. But they're fighting Twitter on their own home turf. And that's really not going to be a winning strategy over time, because they still depend on a service which is making a competing product to their cute, novel broadcasting solution. So the fact that they're waiting this long, that they've even waited this long to not push out some Android version, which, again, if you're worried about compatibility, I mean, it sucks, but you at least get the buzz on, well, we're going to start with the Samsung Galaxy S6. You know, like, we're going to start with one phone, but now it's on Android, and we'll quickly try and add new phones just to make sure that the experience is exactly what we want it to be, no matter what phone you pick up. But that's constant headlines. That's constant chatter.
I agree, but you don't even just start with one. Technically, you could start with every single flagship this year, because it's running Android 5.0. Done.
Well, the only reason I say, you know, if you're really concerned about compatibility, if you're really concerned about the experience being what you want it to be, you slow play it. But if you slow play it, there are always pros and cons. But if you slow play it, then you get more headlines with each, like, Android blog out there. Now we're supporting HTC devices. Ooh, HTC One owners can now use Meerkat. And that's another blog post that you got, that you're constantly reinforcing the brand image. Sure.
You should go over to HTC and say, you have the let's make it work.
Right.
You know?
Make it work. To not have some kind of partnership in there. The one partnership they have is Twitter. They have to for some reason, they had to partner with Twitter. Twitter owns Periscope. That is a dumb partnership for them to have.
Partner with the owner of your biggest competitor?
No, they partner with, I'm not exactly sure how it started, but I know that Periscope came out of nowhere to them. Like, it looks like basically Twitter was like, yeah, we'll do the partnership, and then they're like, here's our new company right here. So, I mean, you know, it's one of those things. But anyway, we've discussed, like, two things already off the list here. Moving back to Microsoft, rumor has it that Microsoft is going to announce 4 new devices with the launch of Windows 10, 2 flagship and 2 mid-range. And the flagships are going to be the they're calling it the new Lumia 940 and 940 XL. It looks like Microsoft is going with that XL route, which, you know what, it's kind of smart, because your 1520 and your 930 are the same thing. Really? It's just screen size difference. And then,
well, I think it'll just help them clear up the confusing naming that they've done.
Yeah, exactly. And then the mid-range would be a 745 and a 745 XL. And the flagship, in terms of the flagship, you're looking at a 24 to 25 megapixel camera, 5 megapixel front facing snapper, running Windows 10. No word on processor, even though Windows 10 OS will support hexa-core processors and octa-core processors, so most likely be an octa-core, since, you know, that's what's available now. The XL will be 5.7 inches in size, and then the regular the device would be roughly around 5 inches or so. And between Q2 and Q3, so we're looking at launch of Windows 10 till about, you know, September, I guess, pretty much. So all depends. But I think the flagship will probably come first, and the mid range will probably come later on, because you don't want to compete against the iPhone launch and then the.
I would really hope that they do that, but again, I also would really have hoped that they would have updated by now. You know, so it's been a little stark in the Windows Phone discussion arena not having a flagship. You know, like, even for their sales mostly being focused on the low end, it's kind of like owning a car dealership. You get someone in the door because you've got a sexy Corvette out in the window, and then you sell them, like, a Chevy Aveo, you know?
Oh, my God.
It's still exciting for them to walk in and see, like, when we went and bought my little hatchback, I've got a little Versa Note. And you walk in and you're like, GTR, I would love to take that for a test drive, but I'm here to buy a Versa Note. Like, it's still part of the experience. So, you know, it kind of keeps the discussion alive. It keeps people excited about the brand, and it keeps people excited about the property. But I just really hope that this is almost exclusively, you know, Nokia hardware DNA, that they don't get too surfacey about it, because I still love, you know, like, I still use my Icon on a very regular basis, and it's still one of the best phones in my collection.
Those are good phones. I mean, the sad and good thing about the devices is that if you take the Lumia 1520 and the 930 and stack it out to any device today, it will still hold its own. So it's almost like Microsoft went through that old school mentality of building it to last. Why? Why would you do such a thing? That is foolish.
No, this thing needs to feel like I should have thrown it away after 6 months.
I mean, but that's really is the sad thing about it. It was just funny because I took the 930 and I'm holding it. I'm like, it's still fast. The camera is still better than
most of the other cameras out on the market. I would say it's the only camera that is giving the 930 and 1520 a run for its money are the cameras in the Note and the Galaxy S6.
Yeah.
It's not a clear victory. It's not a runaway victory. They're very, very close.
Close, yeah. No, I will agree. I mean, the 1030 is still, 1020 is still king. I'm sorry, I had to do that. So anyway, moving on from that to another Microsoft news, which is kind of a bummer, and this should have been uselessness. Verizon users who are looking to buy the S6 or the S6 Edge will not have Microsoft apps. Now, that's the deal that came with Samsung and Microsoft, which means also you don't get that 100 gigabytes of
OneDrive.
Gone. So it's kind of a bummer that, you know, they're excluding that there. But it's also kind of sad because then on the other flip side, you have T-Mobile who said if you pre-ordered, you get 1 year of Netflix.
What is Verizon's thought process?
None.
They don't need to play ball with anyone. They're Verizon. They're the number one.
Yeah.
Sam, they're winning. Point. They're the winners, Sam. They don't have to do anything that you want them to do. They're the best. They've got those really great off-center checkmark logos on all of their phones.
Can you hear me now? but I remember a company called Sprint that used to be like, yeah, we have such a huge user base, and we have this Nextel thing, and we have all these technologies that make people want to stay with us. Yeah. Keep going that route. Let's see how that works out for you.
That's that. That's pretty much it for tech. Unless there's anything else before we jump into entertainment, anything you guys can think of?
Let's see. I saw a bat jet in a video. That's tech.
No one's talking about the bat wing here.
Oh, yet. No, there is one more story. There is one more story that we do need to cover, and it's super small. We don't need to spend a lot of time on it. We probably will. No, I wanted to get your guys' reactions. I'm not even going to describe it too much. I wanted to get your guys' reactions to the IKEA announcement.
You mean the IKEA wireless furniture stuff?
Yeah, they have a whole line of wireless charging products. They have docks. They have little base stations, so if you just want a pad, just like we've seen before. But then they have a desk, an end table, and three different lamps that have charge cradles built into them. And they're also going to release a drill kit so that you can install wireless charging into their furniture. So if you already have like an IKEA coffee table, it's this really big round drill kit that drills up under the bottom of your desk, so then you can stick in a wireless charging and hide wireless charging into your pieces of furniture.
I like the idea. I'm a big wireless charging guy, so for me it's cool. As long as it's not too expensive, and as long as, you know,
it shouldn't be that expensive.
Yeah, no, I'm just saying in general, as long as it's not too expensive. But I like the idea, I'm sure we're going to see some...
That's another thing. Actually, I've got the press release pulled up. What would be too expensive when we're already talking about the price of IKEA furniture?
Yeah. I think this is a pretty good way of getting wireless charging to the masses, because a lot of people, think about it, the people who really buy a lot of IKEA furniture are people living in apartments. So this big cities like New York, you find a lot of people going to IKEA to buy furniture. College students, single folks.
Oh, and they will be releasing cases. So you can get like a snap-on back case for the iPhone 4, 5, and 6 and the Galaxy S3, 4, 5 so that you can add wireless charging to these phones.
Well, I mean, the thing also is that, remember, IKEA is a European company, and Europe is one place where they basically mandated that everybody use a micro USB. And, you know, to take away from the wires and all those issues, I think that's why IKEA is trying to, not necessarily trying to champion or push, but they know that it makes business sense because, you know, people just didn't want to fuss with wires at all over there. So it makes good business sense to come up with furniture, especially if it's desks and, you know, office tables. Those are very simple, and somebody can look in and go, yeah, I mean, like, I'm going to be sitting down here 8 hours any day anyway, so I might as well just drop my stuff on there, right? And then, you know, if it's a desk, it's like, well, it's a side table. Yeah, for sure. You know, I don't have to plug in so many wires. I can just drop my devices on top of it. So those are the kind of things. I think it's nice. I think it's a solid move.
So let's play a game. Okay, so I'll pick the most expensive product that has wireless charging. This is the Varv floor lamp with wireless charging. It includes a USB port. It's powder-coated steel and ABS plastic, nylon and polyurethane shade, in compliance with California Title 20 regulations. And it's a really high-quality floor lamp, which has a little shelf that sticks out about halfway and has a wireless charging plate on that. How much does that cost?
$49.
Probably $100. $99.99. Probably $100 in the max. Or $120.
Sam nailed it. It's $119.
Okay.
So their standalone chargers, I think, are actually pretty reasonable. Just a one-pad charger is going to be $27.99. Their three-pad charger is going to be $65.
I cheated because I saw that when I was trying to buy a lamp last week.
Oh, you
criminal.
Dick.
I didn't order that one. I ordered a different one. But yeah.
But the one thing I'll add to all of that is I think they're the first. I think IKEA is betting on the right technology. They're all QI chargers. There's no PMI or anything weird. I spell it just because no one knows what chi is. I get so much crap in all of my videos that I'll purposely say charger. It's a QI charger, chi, and people be like, "It's you don't need to say QI. It's just a chi charger." And you're like, "No one knows what that is."
It is this.
No idea what that is.
Chi.
I don't know. I've got a Vegeta poster on my wall. I don't know nothing about no chi. This is about power. I think IKEA is betting at the right time because it's still fresh, and you're starting to get phones like the Galaxy S6 where it's just built in. You don't have to mess with the funky backplate, and that I think they're gonna score big on these. I think this is gonna be a really big product line for them because consumers are gonna walk in and go, "Ooh, what does that do?" And then they're going to also look at their phones and go, "I wish my phone did that."
Oh, here's a case.
Right?
Yeah. No, that's true. Oh, one more thing I forgot. OnePlus One is going to make an announcement April 20th. I don't think it's OnePlus 2 because the CEO said that's Q3, so idea what this device is. Okay, so meh. All right, then. Now that meh is out and we are ready to move on to entertainment, and we have a Star Wars T-shirt there with those are not what are those Ewoks? Yes,
Ewoking Dead.
Yes, Ewoking Dead, and of course I'm representing here over with Big Ass, and we start off with the first trailer. Now I've done my my analysis.
I'm drinking out of my sassy Superman mug. Look, he's on his shoulder. He's got those pouty lips going on.
He's like he's bundling. Superman. I know, right?
I'm Superman. That's what I do. I do super.
So let's talk trailers. This week I actually started off with Ant-Man trailer, which we talk about later. It's not that important right now.
get to the point. Let's get it because we got a lot to talk about.
Star Wars: The Force Awakens trailer.
Boom.
Your thoughts, Juan. Starting with you.
So I have been trying to keep expectations in check. I am a cynical, skeptical shit of a human being.
And the second, oh, we know that.
Oh, yeah. You know, I mean, it should be abundantly clear if you guys have been watching this show with us at all. But the second that trailer wrapped up and we got that closing scene, which I was mad that people were ruining a trailer. Like, people would cut immediately, like, in talking about the trailer to Han and Chewie. And you get that last moment, and it was really hard not getting emotional. It was really difficult. I didn't actually shed a tear, but the eyes got a little misty. The heart kind of creeped up into my throat a little bit. It's hitting all the right notes. It's hitting all of the right notes. I mean, my wife summed it up perfectly, where she was so stoked by the trailer, she watched it a second time, and it was in watching it a second time, because she had to watch it at work, and watching it a second time when she realized what that giant shape in the background is when they're sort of panning across that scene. You see the X-Wing crash, and then she was like, oh, that's cool, they've got a crashed X-Wing. And then she watched it again and was like, oh my god, that's a Star Destroyer! All of the reveals are on point. All of the voiceover is on point. I mean, it perfectly is capturing the vibe and the spirit of everything that I love about the original trilogy. And I'm trying to keep expectations in check. It's just a movie. It's going to be the first of a trilogy. There are probably going to be missteps. But damn, I want this to be good. Damn, I want this to be good. And it looks like it's on the right track.
All right, cool. Sam, how about you? I mean, we talked about it a little bit yesterday, so.
Yeah, no, I think I agree with everything Wanda said. I think it was very, very clear that they were basically saying this is everything everyone has wanted, which is basically everything from the original trilogy, in episodes 1, 2, and 3, and then we'll bury Jar Jar Binks under 6. You know, episodes of awesome movies, and just forget about what that character ever was, and that's pretty nice. But I think even the Han Solo ending with Chewbacca, that was cool. But I just really like the idea that it might be going into a different aspect of the canon. You know, before it's always been around the Skywalker family, right? People haven't really realized how pivotal the union of Solo and Princess Leia actually was in basically determining what the balance of the Force would be. The twins, that's the big thing, the twins. You know, Luke Skywalker was a pair of twins with his sister Leia and himself. Now it's another set of twins, which is Princess Leia's kids. So how's that gonna play out? And if you actually listen to the read part of the canon, it's interesting to see where to pick this off at. You know, is this, you know, are they going to go with, you know, one twin gets corrupted, or are they going to go with they're trying to kidnap these, you know, Force-sensitive kids? And it looks as though they're going in a very interesting route, because you have Luke Skywalker narrating at the start, you know, my father had the Force, my sister had the Force, I had the Force, you have the Force. I'm like, we all have the Force, Luke. No, but it's really cool. No, I really, really like where they're going. And I think just the whole idea that you have, just from the voice, something that sounds like it looks Skywalker that's a little kind of down. He's experienced a lot. He's come from a place where probably Jedis don't exist anymore, so you can hear it in his voice. You can hear that tiredness in his voice, and you're like, okay, what the heck happened to Luke Skywalker? What the hell happened to him? And you just want to know. It's pretty cool. I think this is going to be probably the best movie of the year when it comes out. I'm just going to say.
Yeah. I gave my thoughts. I was creamed because I didn't recognize Luke Skywalker's voice. Sorry.
So much bad Star Wars fan.
I know.
Everybody, I mean, to be fair, I am a voiceover guy, so the second he started speaking, that's Mark Hamill.
No, see, that's the thing. Like, everyone, you can check out the videos. Like, tons of people, like, you don't know his voice. I'm like, the only voice I know from Mark Hamill is the Joker, as far as I'm concerned. I never liked Luke. I hated him. So his voice, I blocked. If you mention Han Solo, Chewie, even Princess Leia, I recognize those voices. Luke, I hated as a kid, so I could care less about him. But it was cool. It was a really cool trailer. I love the imagery. I love his use of mixture of practical and special effects. I love the scale. I love his scaling. You know, I didn't notice the X-Wing at first. I noticed the Star Destroyer. I was like, wow! And then the fifth time I watched it, I saw the X-Wing. I was like, oh, okay, that's there. You know, and this just, you know, even when Millennium Falcon was chased by the TIE fighters, and then he does that zoom in, and you see how massive the Star Destroyer is, because you're going through the engine exhaust port of the Star Destroyer, and you're like, shit! Like, that is just huge. It's huge. And to a certain degree, I think the inclusion of Han and Chewie at the end didn't make sense for the trailer, but it only made sense for fan service, and that's why it was good. Because
totally.
Yeah, for the trailer, it was like, and next minute, you're like, okay, cool. And then But once you, what I liked for that part was not even that he was there, was the fact that his facial expression finally told me that yes, he is back in the Star Wars franchise. Yeah. Not that it, not that he's doing it just because he's getting paid, but he was like, yeah, well,
cough, cough, Ender's Game, cough, cough.
Oh god, don't even talk about that movie.
So, yeah, it was good. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I do agree with Sam. I think that would be the biggest movie this year.
Yeah. I mean, again, yeah. I think just like when the prequels came out, like especially for Episode One, before we knew what we were in for, when that movie went out at the movie theater, you could only buy a certain number of pre-sale tickets. There was no online database for, you know, like a lot of movie theaters will let you even pick your seats, you know, so there wasn't anything like that.
Man.
And so they had these really restrictive rules. Like, you could only buy a couple tickets. You're not allowed to line up at the movie theater before, so they weren't going to let people camp out. But they had, like, this zone where it's like, you can't line up, but people would wait outside the zone. So there was a line of people outside the zone, and then there was, like, a rush. Like, you had to run to get to the movie theater as soon as they opened up the zone. And so we had this insane plan. Like, it was me and a couple friends with mountain bikes. we were all waiting, and just like about 10 minutes before the zone went up, and we were pretty close to the front of the line, but 10 minutes before the zone went up, like a buddy of mine drove up and like dropped off mountain bikes and then drove away. And then they opened up the zone, we're like pedaling, we're going to be the first to get tickets for Star Wars.
Wow. Oh my god.
So I mean, if we can get back to that, to just to that sense of magic that the original trilogy installed, and that the prequels sort of squashed a little bit. But if we can get people excited like that again, it would be amazing. Because there's something really magical about that one big common shared experience.
But let's even put this in context, right? I wasn't alive when the first Star Wars was made. That was before my time. And probably before any of our times here. This, we're talking about probably our oldest siblings, if not oldest cousins' time, right? Now, the fact that we still feel this way about it says a lot about what that movie did for a lot of people's childhood. If you are a geek and you are into like sci-fi and swords and lasers and stuff like that, it's the first real major movie that really took on sci-fi in a kind of sword and board kind of way. Normally sci-fi was the whole laser guns and stuff, but it's like you have a sword, but it's a laser. It's like, what are you doing? And it was so cool. So there's really still that magic, and the fact that it's turned into this whole massive universe, it's something that's going to continue to engender just, a feeling of just euphoria among like generations of geeks to come. And there's no way that a movie from Star Wars, unless they totally bungle it, isn't going to generate some kind of excitement from anyone who considers themselves a geek.
No, definitely. So I think they hit the right tones. Trailer was good. We're gonna get another trailer with Ant-Man, I think, because that's in July. And then it's on to December, and then it's that's it. They just better nail out of the park, and I need to see some good fight scenes with Jedi lightsabers. But I don't think we will, because no, we won't. But anyway, I decided thinking about the characters. All right, moving on to the second trailer. This is my own cup of tea. Batman v Superman trailer hits.
Well, and properly got released. I mean, as soon as the leak happened and I saw your photo of like, why don't you just put it out, Zack Snyder?
Yeah, no, but dude, it leaked 7 p.m. the day before. So they actually released it a full 24 hours. I'm thinking they wanted some of that Star Wars buzz to die down a little bit before even they dropped the full trailer. Yeah. Or maybe also they just been they have, I know they struck some deal with Disney to actually have Batman Superman go with the movie, so it might be something like that. But anyway, your thoughts, Juan. Your thoughts.
Okay,
let's preface this by saying
Juan.
Juan was not Juan. Impressed with the original Superman that I hear.
So, sorry. I'm so sorry.
No, I love that my reputation for not liking Man of Steel is being introduced because it
gives everybody a context on what you think about, you know, the prequel.
I was definitely going to bring that up too, because I'm not impressed with Man of Steel, and I don't think it's a very good story, because it doesn't.
Awesome movie.
It's on its own. It is an incomplete story, and I don't like having to spend 3 hours of my life watching an incomplete story. if you're gonna pick a part of Superman's life to showcase, you can tell a complete story within that context. You don't need to rely on multiple films to get the same story across. And I thought we learned that with Nolan. As we went through the Batman franchise, but I digress. So this film has a lot on its plate for it to address the deficiencies of Man of Steel for me personally as a viewer. But what I am happy to see is I think they're getting the political vibe right. This trailer is doing an amazing job of showcasing. There are tremendous ramifications for a superpowered being just landing in the middle of, you know, Metropolis, I guess, and showing us that we're, one, not alone in the universe, and two, that we're not as powerful as we thought we were. And if that's what the sort of core messaging is a world that's learning to recognize its place in the galaxy, and a being that's learning how to recognize his place on a planet of people that are not as powerful, not as advanced as him, I think that is some of the character arc that was sadly missing, sorely missing, from the first Superman film for how long it was. So if we get to address that and we get to come to grips with what all of this means and what it means to be a superpowered individual and how that's going to affect everything around him, that's cool. I'm still kind of bummed that Superman is apparently going even darker. I want us to get to a point at some point where Superman can come to represent the bright, shining beacon of hope that I think he was with the Christopher Reeve films in the comic books. I don't like that the lessons we seem to be learning mostly from DC are, well, Batman was successful, so everything has to be dark and gritty and edgy and dark. And did I mention it was going to be dark? Because it's going to be dark and edgy.
See, I'll have to disagree with you. I don't think it is, but then it's a trailer. I think
the trailer is super intense, though.
No, it's intense. It's intense. I don't think it's dark. I think I mean the darkness of the trailer.
Trailer is dark.
No.
The scene where all the soldiers are bowing down, and you have
and everything's built up on. I mean, like Superman.
Yeah.
Built on religious iconography.
Oh yeah, yeah. Of course,
always been a god character, a god complex character, a risen sun character. I mean, he's literally
he was in this
of a sun.
Yeah, he was in the sky there. The woman was pointing. That was bright.
That's one scene. So it starts with like all of the women painted for like Dia de los Muertos, and then and it wraps with the fight between him and Batman. I mean, everything about the trailer is as dark and as gritty as a trailer can go. And I think the film still needs to address a lot of what does it mean to be Superman? And you have a lot of classic Superman fans who are not turned on by dark, edgy Superman. We miss having goofy, affable, lovable Clark Kent.
I don't. I hate it. I don't like it. I mean, I agree with you. I understand. I mean, I think that was... I looked at it as more like that was that Superman. That was also Christopher Reeves. And then when I saw it with Brandon Routh, I almost threw up.
Oh, no. He did a miserable job of...
And so for me, I was like, no. I'm not saying that we should go... I agree with you that, yeah, there should be some lighthearted, you know, moments.
I think we're ignoring a small part of the audience. Not a majority of the audience, not even, like, a good chunk, but a small part of the audience that, you know, we used to have Lois Lane comic books, right?
No.
And I know that that was a really cynical way, like, back in the 60s.
Yeah.
The 60s or 70s. I know that was a really cynical industry move to try and get girls into comics. You know, like, we'll make a phone and we'll paint it pink because that's what girls want. But that really did lay the foundation for shows like Lois and Clark. And I don't think Lois and Clark is great Superman storytelling, but it was an entertaining way to explore sort of a romantic dramedy or drama comedy featuring characters that are, you know, really accessible and really identifiable. And, you know, it brings people like my wife. It kind of fills in the Superman universe for people like my wife, because that's an interesting side story to what it must be to be Superman, you know? And you lose out on a lot of the tension, a lot of what's fun about Superman. Not action and cool and hardcore about Superman, but what's fun about Superman when he doesn't have an alter ego. When Lois Lane knows that Clark Kent is Superman, you've given up one of the core aspects of the character, in that I think Superman enjoys the cat and mouse game of not being discovered for who he really is. Mm. So there are little things like that that I think we miss the bright, we miss the fun, and I still think that that's going to be lacking in this film, but I do want them to explore some of those big questions and the big action and the big moments of Superman, and I think the trailer is at least lining us up for that.
I was with you in the first movie when they basically said, "Oh wow, Lois Lane now knows who Superman is." But then it struck me as like, you know what? I've always thought it was kind of silly that she didn't get the fact that the same guy with glasses, it's really the same guy, you know. So to me, I think they decided to basically let go of that goofiness and just go straight into reality. And I think that's what Batman Superman's going to answer. Who are you? Why would Superman, probably the strongest being on the face of the planet, choose not to use 100% of his powers at every single time? You know, after he's literally destroyed probably one or two cities in the United States, maybe that's why he holds back. Maybe that's why he doesn't go ham every single time. Maybe that's why Superman wants to fight more in the skies and in outer space than he does on Earth. Maybe this is start answering some of those questions that we've always said, this is kind of silly about the comics. Like, why would anyone do that? You're the strongest person in the world. Why wouldn't you just, you know, deck him, give him one swift punch and that's it, you know? that might start, like, you know, giving him an appreciation for when Superman fights, like, all these basically humans with machines. Why doesn't he just, like, go straight up, just, you know, use one of his superpowers and end them? Maybe this story builds on why Superman now appreciates how fragile human beings are. You know, there are a lot of different things they can do with this, and I like the fact that you're going in that direction. I actually kind of enjoy that.
See, what I enjoyed from the trailer is that everything we saw, I think, is just the first act. Literally, in terms of the discussion and in terms of a teaser trailer, this was the best teaser trailer I have seen in roughly a year. Star Wars teaser trailer was not that good. Not the trailer, I'm saying the teaser trailer.
Right.
This teaser trailer told me that the world fears Superman. Some people love him, some people worship him. He's got some guys with S-crests with neo-Nazis. That was the one I was like, I hope he's going there to say, guys, you need to stop whatever you're doing, because this is creeping me out too. Because at first I saw it, I saw the leaked version, I thought it was just U.S. soldiers, you know, who had seen him and like, whoa. And then when you watch it again, you're like,
Yeah. and that's what I think when once it's really dark, I think that scene.
That's where Juan was like, give me Christopher Reeves back.
Yeah, I mean, because the funny thing is, especially for how much we're making fun of me in this moment, is that you're not wrong. I worry. Again, this isn't something that I think is a deal breaker, and I don't think it's a misstep. I just worry when we get a little too heavy-handed with the religious iconography with a character like Superman, because it's a very subtle subtext that he is a Jesus character. Yep. That he is a god character. I mean, he is piggybacking on, you know, since the days of Egyptian lore, the sun god. Yep. He's just a comic book representation of that. So I get a little twitchy when we make it overt, when, you know, we have the scene of him false god is, yep, spray painted on the statue of that Superman's chest, and, you know, people are bowing and kneeling and prostrating themselves. And I know that that's got to be a discussion in the current climate of, you know, sort of the religious strife that we have today, but I worry when we get a little too overly focused on that as being part of the Superman mythos and part of the Superman storyline. So again, I'm not saying that that's bad, I'm just saying it does make me a little worried if we get too hung up on that, because I think it does a disservice to the character.
No, I hear you. I think...
There's a comment on here from Justice Hampton before. He says, U.S. soldiers, come on, we don't bow to no one.
America!
No, I hear you with those. I think for me, I just kind of look at it and I go, not that I know the human race, I'm an expert, but I understand human beings to a certain degree. We are foolish and we also do useless things too. So I can guarantee there will be sexy human beings who will go, he's a god. There's sex human beings who would do the Republican thing. Sorry. I didn't throw that in there. but I hear you with those elements. I'm sorry. But the other part, I mean, so what did you think about, so that was one half of the trailer, literally. We just talked about one half only.
Right.
The other half was Ben Affleck and Batman. And, you know, it shows you.
So the one scene on the top of the spire where Batman sort of surveying the city just looked a little awkward. It didn't quite have the same majesty that we saw with the Dark Knight, you know, when he's in China and he's standing on top of that skyscraper.
Yeah.
It just I don't know what I can't put my finger on what sort of, it looks like he's kind of clinging to it, not like he's Batman, you know, like I'm ready to jump off this thing.
Yeah.
It just looked a little cautious. I don't know. And maybe that'll even work into the storyline, and maybe I'm reading too much into that. I'll sum it up from the Q&A from Mike L. Beard, because this is exactly how I felt.
Yes.
Know how I know you're a beast? Ask Superman if he bleeds, and then tell him that he will. Only Batman would take someone he isn't even sure can be hurt. He will find a way to hurt them. Yes. Always be Batman. Always be Batman.
You know what, though? From that comment, I'm going to start calling Ben Affleck Ben the Beast Affleck.
Ben the Beast Affleck. But I wanted to ask you guys what you thought of, what you thought of Bat Voice. Because that's always going to be a tricky debate. I think one of the few people who got Bat Voice right for live action was Michael Keaton.
Yep, got it right, but I think this is better than the last. But I think
this is better than like Chris Evans. I like this
Bat Voice. Now, I'm not sure exactly if this is just specifically for the armored suit, as compared to him out of the armored suit, but especially watching the high def trailer when he said it. Like if I was Superman, I would have just flown and decked him. That's what I just would have done. out of anger from
No. So here's the deal. This is the thing that pisses me off about comic book live action logic.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Superman should just fly in and deck him. Just eliminate the threat.
No, instead,
Yep.
But it's the same problem I have with the Flash. The Flash goes up against non-superpowered people all the time.
He runs and he stops
and he stands there and he lets them do something. Okay. And like, if you're really going to disarm the situation, run in, knock them out before they have even blinked, because you can go that fast. Just knock them out and then assess the situation and see what it is that you need to do to rectify what the problem is.
Okay, he's wearing a bright red and yellow suit.
And he wants to make sure that people know that he looks pretty.
Exactly.
Like, pretty.
And go.
No, man.
So with Superman, they always write it as arrogance. Like, oh, I know I can't be hurt by these puny little humans, so I'll just fly here and do a really dramatic thing. And I get that, but it's lazy. It's lazy. If you can't write an interaction with another superpowered individual, another comic book character, where they can't take Superman at his actual level, then what are we doing? We're sort of wasting time.
You see, that's the thing.
But the honest truth is how would you write it? The honest truth is...
Well, that's the problem with the Superman character, isn't it? Because
not even Superman. Forget Superman. Even Flash, too, right? Flash is not as powerful as Superman, although he's fast. And you have to still have that confrontation. The best scene I saw was, if you've seen the Avengers clips, the TV spots and all, there was one cool one where Ultron is talking and then Tony Stark comes and he's like, so what are you going to do with the vibranium? He's like, yeah, this is when I tell you my evil, whatever, just blast him. I'm like, yeah, that's the most you can do, but you have to always set up that confrontation.
Well off the top of my head, I would say if I were a normally powered human, which I am, and I had to go up against a superpowered individual like the Flash, knowing that he's super fast, I would do a bunch of things to try and
trip him.
try and trip them up, try and negate that speed advantage. You know, things like setting up trip wires, ball bearings, oil slicks all over floors, making them run through an obstacle course. You know, it wouldn't just be like, I've got a gun and I'm going to go rob a bank, and then the flash just runs up and stops right in front of me. Oh no, I better shoot at the flash. You know, like that does, it's lazy. It's lazy writing when that's the way that you write a confrontation, when that's how you write conflict.
But I think this is part of what, I think hopefully this movie addresses basically this as a consequence of the first movie. At the end of the first Superman movie, we see massive destruction. Basically, they've basically leveled Metropolis. So maybe I'm hoping that basically this is more like Superman can't just go and go hitting humans, because the whole world sees him as, oh my God, this guy is totally super powerful. He's about to deck a regular human being. Like, wow, why would he do that? He can just do anything else. Why does he have to kill this guy by just punching him? And I think that's where you start saying why Superman has to hold back. Why these super meta humans?
Oh no, but I mean, even Superman holding back should be able to swoop in and affect Batman before Batman realizes what's going on. You know, I mean, like, or just zoom in right behind him and like push him. You know. But instead, we've got to have the bravado moment, and that's actually, you know, like for the Batman character, that's really the only way that you can write a showdown between Superman and Batman, is Batman knowing his opponent isn't going to do that.
Yeah.
Because
he's
arrogant and also sort of condescending. He's patronizing. He doesn't respect humanity as an adversary, so he can use that to his advantage in actually giving Superman a fight, you know? And that's frustrating, though, is that's how you write every single Superman story, because Superman is grossly overpowered for the rest of the sort of Earth-based characters that Superman interacts with.
Until Aquaman comes and uses that trident on his ass.
Actually, I mean, it's I want to see a good showdown between Superman and Wonder Woman. I really do. I'd love to see, like, you know, like how you got that Thor, Iron Man, Captain America scene in Avengers. I want Wonder Woman as a brawler. I really want to see, like, and again, Superman needs to learn some respect. There are other people out there that Superman needs to
learn about. Which was your best, which line did you like in the trailer? Because Sam's best line was the last one where he says,
definitely, it's the Batman line.
My best line was, I liked Lex's line. I liked the delivery, even though it was, I still heard Jesse Eisenberg's voice, but I liked the way he said
it. It was really good, though. Yeah.
I was like, oh my God, that is so Lex. Mm-hmm. And which also brings to me a good point that you can tell, even from the trailer, you can tell that this was written by Chris Terrio and not David Goyer. David Goyer probably laid out the story outlines like, let's do this, let's do this. Totally. And Chris just wrote out, because when you hear that intro where, you know, Holly Hunter is going, you know, absolute power corrupts absolutely, and then you hear Neil deGrasse Tyson's voice in there, and all that stuff, but you're hearing the quotes, you're like, okay, this is nice, and then you hear Lex's line, I was like, oh God, Lex is going to manipulate the shit out of Superman. I could see it now, completely. And I was like, all right, I'm glad that they got another writer for this. So that whatever time delay they took, it's worth it at this point, just because, you know, it would have been something completely different. But moving on, since we've
if basically you want to see a good superhero, I shouldn't say superhero, a good metahuman just going crazy, look at the Hulk movie. What he did to the character. Remember that scene where basically
the dude
shooting at him with tanks, and then Hulk just grabs him and goes bam, 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 bam. I'm like, yes. That's how you take care of it.
All right, let's quickly go through the rest. Wonder Woman changed directors. One of the former directors. It moved on to Patty Jenkins, who directed Monster. But Variety came out and stated a couple of reasons why that didn't happen. So she wanted to make it a very grand movie, according to reports from Variety. And Warner Bros. Wanted to make it character-driven. They wanted to make this a more character-driven storyline.
No.
And
brawler, superhero, come on.
Yeah.
What they've been doing, the character-driven kind of
story. I prefer the character-driven for Wonder Woman than necessarily just a pure...
I want the Wonder Woman storyline from New Frontier.
Yeah, but that was character-driven also.
No, if I wanted to roll into China and arm a bunch of women to overthrow oppressive, you know, males. Like, I want her to be just as brutal as Superman. I don't want a character-driven... Maybe she'll get a boyfriend at the end. Like, why are we doing this? Wonder Woman.
I see. Well, it all depends. But anyway, they also stated that she also wanted Wonder Woman to have a pet tiger that talked. Something that was in the comic from like 1940, yeah, which I was like,
I'd be fine losing that.
Yeah, but it seemed
about the pet tiger stuff.
It seemed like they were on different paths on this. So
yeah, and I think they were concerned about her experience. She had a lot of TV experience, but she didn't really have like movie experience. And what the scope of what she was trying to do, I think the company just didn't have faith that she could pull
off. Well, yeah. And then also, I mean, if she's talking up things like she wants to resurrect stuff from the 70s comics, and she's probably just not, you know, like that could have been a really entertaining and interesting movie depending on how you did it. But they're obviously not on the same pulse. They're not seeing eye to eye. I mean, like, I think that's a perfectly fine reason to sort of dissolve. It's the same thing that happened with
Edgar Wright
and Ant-Man. Exactly. Yeah. If you guys aren't gelling, don't
do it. Yeah.
Don't force that movie because you're going to end up with Alien 3. You know.
But here's the funny part. So Patty Jenkins was in line to do Thor 2, and she and Marvel did not gel on the same path, and Thor 2 to me was not that good.
I thought it was cotton candy. You know, I had fun when my butt was in the seat and we got to see sort of fantasy, sci-fi, action, spectacular. And then I kind of got on with my life afterwards. I didn't go back to watch Thor like I did even Iron Man 3.
But the whole character-driven aspect.
I'm sorry. I love the extremist storyline, and that's as close to it as we would ever get in a live-action movie. So you know, it was what it was.
No, true.
His interactions with the kid are freaking hysterical. So you've got PTSD, Tony Stark taking out his aggression on a little kid. That's awesome.
No. I love
Robert Downey Jr. being a jerk.
But a character-driven storyline for Wonder Woman, it'd be really nice to see some of that arrogance come through, you know, because every time she's always been that, like, oh, she saves people, she just turns around and Wonder Woman, she says, no, let's see that arrogance. This is a god we're talking about. If you think Superman is a false god, she considers herself a god. She's a child of gods, okay?
Well, that's why I also, like, from the most recent animated series, I think have been getting Wonder Woman right a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I want a brawler. I want someone who's unapologetic. I don't want a female character who's gonna in any way be demure or, you know, like, oh, it's a fish out of water story as she tries to, you know, acclimate to what it must be like, you know, working with humans. No, I want her to, like, dictate the terms of every relationship that she sets up.
Steve, sit down. Say yes, ma'am.
And again, I think it's a wonderful opportunity where just like Superman will have to learn some humility or at least learn to treat humanity with some respect because of Batman, Wonder Woman needs a foil like that. Mm-hmm. And it could be a Superman character. After Superman gets his ass beat by Batman, don't underestimate these puny little humans. You know, like, they can fuck you up if they really, really try. And you don't want them to, so back off a little bit, and then they can fight. And then we're like, yes, Wonder Woman just kicked Superman's ass too!
So who's going to tell Aquaman to respect people? Because we all know that out of all of them, he has the worst.
Well, but that's I think, what could be a great setup is Superman learning to respect humanity as more than just like, well, this is the planet that raised me, but more as like, these are capable beings that can you know, F some S up on their own. But then by that point, Superman should be a defender of humanity. So it's not about... Yeah. Aquaman learning to respect humanity because he obviously doesn't because we've been polluting and destroying the oceans. It's about if you're going to affect change, you can't do it through war. You can't just come out here and wreck shit. It's that we've got to be able to work together on this. And that's what Superman needs to be tasked with doing in interacting with Aquaman.
You know what I want to see for Aquaman's unveil in this movie? Him riding a giant seahorse. It's coming out of the ocean.
Right? Yeah. Just like the comics from the 70s.
Yeah, that's just a
point. It should be a talking seahorse. Like
the worst misinterpretation.
No. I'm serious. I think he should ride a seahorse. but no. A badass seahorse and just come out and people, and that's just like a, that's just to you know, to make fun of the whole, you know, Super Friends thing where he was always like,
seahorse. But the thing is, like, it's the worst, like, I always think when, like, what's it called, Aquaman is funny because he's a misinterpretation of Greek mythology where the gods of the oceans were also the gods of writing. It's like, huh? Yeah, they're the ocean gods, but they also created horses.
Right.
All right, let's move on from Wonder Woman.
No. Before we do, we have an amazing comment in the Q&A. Okay. It's maybe the best comment we've ever gotten on our show ever from Joseph Hampton Jr. With one, establish Wonder Woman as someone not to be effed with. Ding. Brilliant. That is an amazing comment. And and I completely agree with his agreeing with me.
You might be right with that, dude. You know, the reason why I said that is this. If you listen to the trailer, right, at the very beginning, when Lex was talking, somebody said this line. I don't know who it refers to, but he says, they brought their warrior with them. Oh, they brought their warrior. Now, right on. There's only one person who's considered a warrior in DC is Wonder Woman. So, but this person sounded like he was scared, so maybe Wonder Woman kicks some ass.
But I mean, that's also what I mean, and if we're going to finally give Wonder Woman her own property, why are we dipping our toe in? I mean, we're ready, we're due. There's no, like, will a Wonder Woman movie work today? A Wonder Woman movie will work today. I mean, if we can do Guardians of the Galaxy with a talking tree and a talking raccoon, we can do a good Wonder Woman movie. I don't understand what this hesitation is. Get it on the books, make it baller, make it big, make it brutal. And this is exactly why I wanted an actress like not Gina Carano, but someone who had that kind of physicality, someone a little stockier, sturdier, so that we could get those amazing fight scene choreography moments that didn't feel overly like dancey or light or CG influenced. You just had someone who was brutal and capable all on their own to handle the stunts. Moving into creating that character for the screen too.
I mean, no, I definitely agree to a certain degree on that, but I mean, I trust Snyder and his guys with action, and
I do, I definitely,
and especially what I saw with Fiora, because I know the actress who played Fiora before she did that, she was dainty, and then I saw her.
It's why I love, because the movie is serviceable at best, but you go and watch the fight sequences in Haywire. And they're phenomenal.
Yeah, but Gina Carano cannot act. And again,
I think Gina Carano actually did a better job than most people are giving her credit for, because they had to redub most of her dialogue, and that's a really hard thing to do. But if you look at her, she's actually rising to the challenge of interacting with some tremendous actors. But, I mean, that's why I'm saying Gina Carano probably wouldn't have been right for the movie, for Wonder Woman. But working with something like that as the base, you know, could have been phenomenal. And I'm sure there you could have gotten an unknown who might have been able to fulfill both of those roles. But I just keep going back. Like, her fight scene with Michael Fassbender is exactly the way that you should always work a fight scene between a woman and a man, especially when the man's got, like, a 2-foot height advantage over this gal. And it doesn't look like they're pulling any punches. It doesn't look like, oh, she got out of it because she was quick and clever and danced around him and did, like, flippy, action-y things that were obviously, like, we're going to cut away and then jump back in and then do creative editing to get her out of this problem. It was, no, she got him in a lead lock and she's got amazing thighs, so she choked the dude out. That dude is dead. Why is that dude dead? Because she choked him the fuck out.
All right, and on that note, we move on to Terminator Genisys. Quickly, thoughts on the fact that that trailer showed us a whole lot of stuff from that movie.
I'm not sure I want to see the movie anymore. Actually, after looking at the previews for it and seeing that part they threw in finally, I'm not sure I want to see it anymore.
I'm still there. Yeah, that I'll side with Sam, but I'll tweak it a little in that I'm still going. I'm a Terminator fan. They've got my money, unfortunately, but I'm definitely a bit more deflated. You know, I'm happy that we're going back to Terminator as time travel and not a weird Matrix-y future Terminator. Yeah. Like, I'm not really particularly interested in what's going on in the future. I want to see what happens when we start messing with time. And I think that's always been more interesting, the more interesting part of the Terminator franchise. So I'm happy we're back to that, but I feel I know a little too much about this movie now. I feel like a little too much has been spoiled.
I do agree. I'm just hoping, I'm still going to see it, I'm hoping that that reveal happens early. If it's early in the movie and it tracks out to be something else, especially that has to do with time itself, then I'm cool. I'm cool with it as long as they play it right. But then again, we know, who knows. But if it's something that happens, you know, if that happens in the first act of the movie, then fine. There's almost a need to, not a need to spoil it, but I can see why you just threw it out there now in the first place. But we'll see how that is. And Fast and Furious hit $1 billion yesterday.
I totally got teary-eyed and choked up at the end of that movie.
Oh, you finally saw it?
I have this like this hard split. Either a movie's got to be like an amazingly created work of art, or it's got to be like the most bubblegum, fast food, action, goofy, dumb. Like, I love the Crank movies. I think the Crank movies are amazing. They're phenomenal films.
It's just adrenaline.
They're like
adrenaline.
They're the best worst movies ever. Get a group of like rowdy dudes together, get maybe mildly intoxicated, throw on the Crank movies, and just guffaw, because they're ridiculous.
Oh, wow.
That is a really fun movie experience for some of the trashiest films ever made. So the Fast and the Furious films, especially once we kind of got through Tokyo Drift, have actually found a voice in creating a really big, dumb, goofy, action spectacular ensemble cast kind of vibe. You know, they're sort of the next incarnation of like the Oceans films, and they don't take themselves as seriously. But so they're a lot more fun.
The Fast and Furious movie, at least Furious 7, was not a car movie, it was a superhero movie.
It totally was. It was a James Bond film in the truest tradition of like the Roger Moore James Bond film.
Oh man.
It was big and bright and goofy and silly and actiony and kind of dumb but really fun.
And I like how they took that whole concept of I forgot what his name. Not Dominic. What's the name of the character of dude who passed away?
I just call him Paul
Walker.
Paul Walker, yeah.
The kid, like, oh, cars don't fly. And they just took that and, like, we are going to make sure that that statement is false from here on.
Yeah.
You kept on going with it. I'm like, okay, it's fun.
I will give it to them, though. Like you said, the way they ended that movie, I was like...
It was a really touching, yeah. I mean, everyone in our audience was, like, was clapping at the end. You saw a bunch of people, like, kind of wiping away tears, and it was a really sweet way to send out that character, especially because there was the fear that they were going to do something really cynical with the character based on what happened to the actor, and I'm really glad that didn't happen.
Yeah, I'm glad they did that, and I'm glad they even from the very beginning, you know, he was. I mean, the way
the way they do sort of anti foreshadowing, you know, like you just come back to me alive, you just come back to me alive.
Yeah, I mean, you knew it was going to happen. I saw a comment from someone who interviewed director James Wan, and they had asked him, they said, what do you expect from this movie? He said, even if this movie was meh, you people have no idea how much we had to redo that. Yeah. As long as people even just enjoy it, I am happy.
But you know what? Like, because you can kind of see in certain sequences, like the first conversation in the film between... Dom and his sister,
yeah.
You could tell was obviously shot after.
Yeah.
You know, so I thought they did a really good job of working in little bits throughout the film to kind of reinforce part of the storyline to kind of like, one, it builds tension because like what might happen to this character if you're really going to work this hard at telling us why you're worried about this character, but that it also sort of reassures the audience at the same time that, you know, we're going to handle this situation respectfully. So I thought they did an amazing job considering what they had to work with, what they had to work through, and knowing that probably was really a really emotional experience for all the people involved as well.
And they could have really taken an easy way out. They could have taken an easy way out with making it like, okay, and then bam. But then they took it in a very classy way. They found a legitimate reason for why a guy who has a wife and basically now two kids, you know, might not be in a movie coming, like in the next movies that come afterwards. So right. I think they did a really great job. They didn't have to go out and be totally obvious about it. They just went and they did it really stylish, really respectfully. And I think his brother filled in for part of the
movie. His brother's filled in for a couple of scenes. I did like that shot when they were driving off. And it, like, for me, I actually choked up at the point when the car started spinning. I was like...
The two roads diverge. You're like, oh, God. Nah. Who the hell is cutting onions in this movie theater?
But, the fact that, what's his face? Dominic's, the actor for Dominic, what's his name again?
Vin Diesel.
Vin Diesel. The fact that Vin Diesel had that voiceover at the end, and the way the voiceover just went, I'm like, you know what? You can say whatever you want about Vin Diesel's acting chops, but the truth of the matter is, the way he delivered that voiceover at the end was just, it was real. You could tell it wasn't Dominic talking. You could tell it was Vin Diesel talking. That was a real moment. It was a real moment. So that was pretty cool.
All right, guys. That is pretty much it. Thank you very much for joining. We did a very extended entertainment section this week. Apologize for that. What can we expect from you next week, Juan?
Okay, so I've got a bunch of, I'm doing Galaxy S6 stuff. I'm still wrapping up my LG G Flex stuff. I'm actually going to be going out to shoot another video comparison between these two phones. But I actually want to take just a second to plug a show I have nothing to do with, and we're not related to these guys in the slightest. A tiny little YouTube channel, which I believe is just named Stuart Foley. But he produces a show called Trek Yards, where it's all of the kind of the nerdiest conversations that I used to get in middle school when we would talk about the different spaceships and starships in Star Trek.
Oh my god.
Like obsessing in every little detail. Well, I believe this ship has 66 decks and uses a quantum processor for some of their it's amazing. I'm not being cynical or sarcastic about it. It is
Can you send the link and we'll put it up with it?
I will absolutely send the link to Stuart Foley. But I really, if you're a Trek fan, these guys are making an amazing show out of just the passion of being Star Trek fans. It's their labor of love. And like they've gone through fan fiction starships. Like they have one on the Axanar, the Ares class starship from the Axanar fan film. They have an interview with one of the ship creators for the Star Trek series. He worked on Enterprise. So they have a 40-minute interview with him talking about making the futuristic Enterprise J that we got to see just a little glimpse of from Enterprise. I mean, these guys are nerd core. And I've been going through all of their episodes and getting into the same debates that I used to get in middle school. Yeah, like, obviously the Borg would be able to take a Klingon cruiser, and this is why you're wrong. And like, brought me all the way back to reading the technical manuals when I was a little kid. Just so good. So yeah, I'll definitely
check it out. Looks like YouTube comments. What does that look like?
Oh, but that's just and that's what's so great is because it's the exact same thing. You know, like people getting in there and talking about like just the most nitpicky minutia of what goes into making an interesting Star Trek ship, because you can't get away with that stuff in any other. I mean, you can get away with lazy design in any other show, but Star Trek fans, Star Trek, if you don't have a good reason why your corridors are shaped the way they are, they will nail you on it. If you overlook some magical technology from the future that they should have, but maybe they didn't include, they will nail you on it. So I mean, it's just like amazing watching these guys go at it.
I remember way back when in a chat room and people talking about the placement of the holodeck. That's when I understood that people get really intense about this. Like, the holodeck cannot be before, it has to be above the bridge. No, it's below the bridge because the bridge is like, I'm like, okay, I'm out of this whole conversation.
and they still have fewer than 900 subscribers. I mean, like, we're not talking about like a group of a huge group of people, but yeah, rather than just plug my own stuff, I needed to share this with other people because these guys are doing awesome work.
Cool stuff. How about you, Sam?
Well, you know what that means. So let's just say work in progress, okay? Work in progress.
Are we referring to the...
Hey, work in progress.
Okay, all right, cool. All right. On my end, the new MacBook... I need to finish that.
Did you include the
well, I'm sure it's your favorite computer. They reinvented the laptop, so you have to love it, right? It's got to be.
I would tell you now, the one thing I love is the build. The build is very solid.
I would expect Apple to do
it. And the setup must be butter smooth.
Oh, get out of here. Oh, my God. Do you know why you say that?
No, so, I don't.
I was setting it up, right? I wanted to do a setup video also, and then I just busted it because It literally took me 30 minutes to set up my MacBook. I was like, I haven't set up a MacBook in a while, so I sent a message to Sam and Gary. I was like, yo, why is this thing still spinning with colors? It hasn't actually moved.
I didn't realize, like, this is the first time I set up a Mac is for an ex, and she bought a Mac because I made sure she got a Mac because they had Geniuses and everybody to help her fix this thing. They had a whole support system there. But when I first set it up, that's the exact reaction I had. Like, are we done yet? No? Okay, let's do this. Are we done yet? Are we done yet? Stop spinning. Are we done yet? Windows is so different. It's a totally different.
Well, and I had the same experience, like reviving my iTunes accounts just to start playing with an iPhone again. Forgetting, it's kind of a chore. I mean, you have to log into a bunch of different places independently, mm-hmm. whereas you just sort of put in one password on an Android phone and you're sort of in.
Yeah. No.
I was really surprised, like that if you were setting up a person on a smartphone, a first time smartphone user or tablet user, the iOS setup experience isn't that streamlined anymore. I'm sure it was great when we were coming out of Palm Pilots and Windows mobile devices, but Apple's sort of fallen behind there too. I don't think the experience is as great as people claim it to be.
No, it's not as
used to it.
Yeah, it's not as smooth as I expected. But the funnier thing was last night. So I installed Parallels. I installed Windows 10 technical preview. And as soon as I install Windows 10 technical preview, now mind you, I have Windows 10 on two machines. I haven't had a single malware show up until I installed it on the Mac. Nice. Immediately it goes, ding, malware detected. I was like, really? Really, Apple?
Malware name, Windows 10.
So it's that, and then I have this guy here. Speaking of Windows Phone, this is the blue HD LTE. I just can't remember how much it is. It's pretty nifty. Doesn't compare camera wise to Nokia stuff or Lumia stuff, but
I mean, obviously they're in terms of design, they're going after HTC though.
Yeah. Yeah, they do, and it's a pretty nifty device. I have to give them kudos though. It's one of those like cheap, affordable, get it, use it type of thing. So, those are my devices for next week. But anyway, again, thank you very much, guys. Don't forget to check out our channels. Check out Mr. Juan Bagnell at Somegadgetguy, and also Somegadgetguy.com is his website. Search him as Juan Carlos Bagnell, or just Juan Bagnell on YouTube, or Somegadgetguy. You will find him on YouTube there. You can follow Mr. Sam, a.k.a. BlackIron_man. That's his Twitter handle, and see his videos on our YouTube channel, Booredatwork. And, of course, just check us out at Booredatwork. It's Booredatwork.com, Booredatwork on YouTube and all social media. And also, check out the Star Trek guys. I have the link for them in the description. I have to go check it out myself because...
Oh, God, this show is so nerdy. I need to prepare you guys because this is like the most obsessive Star Trek nerdcore conversations you can get into. So if you don't think that's your jam, I don't want you going there and harassing these guys because I want them to continue making the show because I am on board. I've gone through about six of their episodes now, and I love it. I love it.
All right, guys. Well, thank you very much, and always enjoy your entertainment.
Bam.